Hello, it's Joseph, and welcome to my channel, where this week's Kerbal Space Program episode is not going to be a Colonizing Kerbin episode. There's a couple of reasons for this. The Colonizing Kerbin series is getting closer and closer to the end. We're nearing the completion of the colonization of Duna and Lathe. And things are getting a little complicated and a little more time-consuming to film the footage. But also this week, I wasted a bit of time doing some R&D on some new craft, and most of them I scrapped and I'm not going to use, and didn't really spend enough time filming footage for this week's episode. And I didn't want to stress myself out and rush an episode and do it halfway effort, so I decided to do this instead. And those of you that recognize the Apollo Saturn V rocket will maybe be wondering, well, what are we flying today? Well, we are flying a recreation of the Apollo 15 mission. Yesterday was the 50th anniversary of the launch date of the Apollo 15 mission, and it is quite an interesting mission in the history of the Apollo program. So at this point, the spacecraft is on its way to orbit. It has jettisoned the first stage, and the escape tower has been jettisoned. And in the spirit of the launch that they did in real life, the burn for the second stage happens continuously without me stopping, waiting to get to apoapsis and setting maneuver node. Instead, I set a maneuver node while it was on its way up, and then used that to help me circularize the orbit. And that was jettisoned before it could be left in orbit. And now we have a safe circular orbit and are about to do our translunar injection burn. So the Apollo 15 mission was the first of the J-type missions in the Apollo program, and Apollo 15, 16, and 17, the final three Apollo missions, were all J-style missions, which were longer duration, more scientifically focused missions. And as we go through this video, you'll kind of see some reasons for why they were longer duration and why this made some adjustments to the mission profile. Nice little view of the moon off there in the distance. Now, of course, I can't perfectly recreate this mission in Kerbal Space Program. After all, the scale of everything is a bit off. Jewel, for example, is the same size, is actually slightly smaller than Earth is in real life. So anyway, at this point in the mission, the translunar injection burn is complete. So the command module separates, turns around, and docks with the lunar module. But after the lunar module and command module separated, what they started doing with Apollo 13 was to have the upper stage fire its engines so that it would remotely, so that it would collide with the moon. And when that collision would occur, a seismometer left by Apollo 12, and also Apollo 14 in this case, would trigger and send back scientific data to Earth. And the neat thing about this was the seismometer, the scientific data they received, helped them learn more about the composition of the moon itself. So fast forwarding, we are now coming to the moon, and we are firing the engines here to circularize our orbit around the moon. And the Apollo missions, those of you that are familiar, followed a free return trajectory, so the orbit would go clockwise all around the moon to make it easier to return to Earth should something go wrong. Now you notice me lowering the periapsis there. So after the Apollo 15 circularized its orbit in for moon, and they prepared for command module, the commander of the mission, David Scott, and the lunar module pilot, James Irwin, to head down to the surface. Alfred Warden brought down the periapsis of their orbit to help the lunar module have enough fuel to land. So the lunar module for the J-style missions had more scientific equipment and so was heavier. And Apollo 11, 12, and 14 all had very little fuel left when they got down to the surface of the moon. In fact, Apollo 11 was about 5 or 6 seconds away from having to abort and fire the separate and fire the upper stage ascent module and return to orbit to be picked up. So doing this maneuver helped save fuel for this heavier lander. Now, my suicide burn there was not perfect. I fired my engines a little earlier, so I didn't replicate that quite as well, but I did slightly replicate that the mission was on a slanted hill. They didn't land on as flat of a surface as they had planned, and that did cause some issues with them trying to release the rover. And in the spirit of the real mission, I too have brought along a rover, as you can see here. Had a little trouble getting it out of the bay, but I willed it out a little bit with a little bit of, you know, just kind of moving the controls back and forth and until eventually it decided to pop itself free. Now, this craft that I have, the Apollo 15 craft, I also have an Apollo 11 craft, and I actually have made these a long time ago, several months ago, and I every now and then I do these for fun. It's usually, you know, if I got like a half an hour to kill and I just want to kind of haphazardly recreate portions of the mission, I can just bring these up and do it. So this was the first mission that they used a rover. Apollo 16 and 17 also had the rover, and they did 3 EVAs for Apollo 15, and they did some interesting things. While they were out on EVA, they collected what was known as the Genesis rock, and scientists believe that this rock contains is a sample of the moon's crust from its early days and could open up a lot of interesting information to the past. My Kerbals decided to stop for the nice view next to this huge giant crater here. By the way, you may have noticed the rover flipping out there, and I am on version 1.12, but I do not believe that the wheels in the game as advertised have been improved. In fact, I think they're worse. You may notice as we go through this portion of the game, of the video, that the rover tends to drift from side to side to side. And that did not happen in 1.11 or 1.10 or anything before that. It seems to be exclusive to 1.12, and it's been pretty annoying. So hopefully Squad will fix that in a patch. So anyway, enough complaining about some of the, you know, oddities of the game. Let's get back to the recreation. So the Kerbals were out on EVA with the rover. And here's another example of the wheels not working as great as they should. This craft has worked better in previous updates of the game. Anyway, so after they planted a flag, the astronauts also put out some scientific experience, including their own seismometer, just like Apollo 12 and Apollo 14. But they also did something interesting. So in Apollo 14, they did the famous, hit a golf ball. And you're going to see the Kerbals do that because one of the scientific experiments does that. But they didn't do the golf ball thing on Apollo 15. What they actually decided to do was to prove Galileo's theory that basically says that when two objects in the same gravitational field have no atmosphere to create drag, they will fall at the same rate. And David Scott performed this experiment in front of a camera, too. He held up a hammer and a feather and dropped them both at the same time, and they landed on the surface of the moon at the exact same moment. So pretty cool things on these J missions. I think in some ways the J missions are more interesting than earlier missions, just because of, you know, the additional focus on scientific discovery and scientific data. Of course, the rovers. Now, the Apollo missions' popularity in the United States went way down after Apollo 11 was over. This mission did slightly boost the interest in the Apollo program because of the rover. But, of course, not enough to increase the funding, which was slowly dwindling over time. After Apollo 11, Apollo's 18 through 20 were quickly scrubbed, even though they had additional Saturn V's that they could use to run those missions. All right, well, our Kerbals are struggling to get back into the module because for some reason my ladders, even though I've done this mission before and they've always worked fine, decided just to, you know, be glitchy and not let my Kerbals actually get into the module. So they're going to return to orbit in just a second, where in real life, the command module pilot, Alfred Warden, was conducting his own scientific experiments in orbit, and the scientific suite on the command module was also expanded for the J-style missions. So he had additional instruments, cameras, to study the surface of the moon from orbit. So the upper ascent stage has separated from the lower stage and is now going into orbit using the spark engine in the game and is going to rendezvous with the command module. I should add that this mission unfortunately had some controversy to it. After the mission was complete, it was discovered that the astronauts had brought some unauthorized material with them down to the lunar surface and then returned them to Earth. There were some postal stamps that they had brought along. They had been paid by a German postal collector and to bring these stamps along. And when NASA discovered this, they essentially blacklisted all three of the astronauts. This was Alfred Warden and Irwin's only space flights, and this was like David Scott's third or fourth. And unfortunately, because of their poor choice, they were not allowed to be a part of the astronaut program. NASA had this policy where basically they didn't want people to commercially profit off of the Apollo program. In fact, there was a memorial they left on the lunar surface during this mission to commemorate astronauts and cosmonauts, Russian cosmonauts, who had lost their lives in the pursuit of space travel. And there was a little controversy with the artists as well, who wanted to make a profit off of the figurine that they left on the surface, but NASA, of course, didn't want any profit to be made. So the lunar module has been jettisoned and is on its way back to the surface of the moon. And when it crashed, Apollo 12, 14, and 15 seismometer sent back scientific data from the impact. And then on the way back, on the J-style missions, there was a data module on the outside of the command module. And Alfred Warden was the first astronaut on these J-style missions to do an EVA in a very high orbit. Every other EVA besides Apollo 15, 16, and 17 was done in low Earth orbit. And so this was the first time an EVA was done between the orbit of the moon and of Earth. Well, we're getting closer to the end of this mission. And basically the only noteworthy historical fact about this mission at this point was that actually one of the three parachutes, which I have way too many of, actually failed to deploy. But thankfully it was designed to land with two parachutes, and the third one was actually extra. Well, that pretty much wraps up the mission and the recreation. I hope you enjoyed this celebration of the 50th anniversary of Apollo 15. And next week, I hopefully will be back to putting out Colonizing Kerbin episodes, and I hope you enjoyed this little detour from the series. Have a wonderful day, and I will see you next time.